Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
If you have been born again by the grace of God, if the holiness of Jesus has been attributed to you and all of your sin has been taken away and nailed to the cross, and if you can stand before God pleading that and that alone, does that mean that personal holiness, ethical holiness in your own life, that that's just an optional extra? Or is holiness an absolutely essential part of being saved? Let me give you an example. You go to a car dealership and you can choose to have the cheaper fabric seats, or you can have the luxury upgrade and upgrade to leather. Is it an optional extra like that? Or is holiness more like being born, and the breath of life must accompany being born? Otherwise, there's a tragic stillbirth. Find out today. We're going to be looking at the book of Hebrews. We're going to be discovering more about the nature of personal holiness, not just the holiness of Jesus, not just the holiness of God, not just the holiness that we receive from God as a gracious gift, but the holiness that we live out in our lives. Is that an optional extra? Tune in and find out. Stay with us as we come to worship our glorious God. Thank you for joining us. My name's Rory McClure. I'm the pastor of Parkside Evangelical Church, and I want to welcome you to this, our online video service. We're going to come to God now, and we're going to hear his invitation to worship. Our call to worship comes from Psalm 99. The Lord reigns. Let the peoples tremble. He sits enthroned upon the cherubim, let the earth quake. The Lord is great in Zion. He is exalted over all the peoples. Let them praise your great and awesome name. Holy is he. The king in his might loves justice. You have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob. Exalt the Lord our God. Worship at his footstool. Holy is he. Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his holy mountain, for the Lord our God is holy. And so we're going to celebrate that holiness of our glorious God in this, our opening hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for your grace and mercy. We thank you that you, the holy, holy, holy God, have found a way to redeem us. Lord, we confess to you we are sinners and we let you down, and yet in your grace and mercy, you sent the holy, eternal Son of God, the Prince of Righteousness, the heir of heaven. You sent him down to take on the limitations of our flesh and blood. You made him one with us. You made him our faithful representative. You executed judgment upon him instead of us, and you have declared us not guilty, and we are free. We praise you and worship you for that. We thank you for the freedom that that gives us. And Lord, now, covered in the righteousness of Christ and pleading him alone, we pray that you would come down to us in power. And wherever we are worshiping you now, as we watch this video, Lord, please bless and help us to know you and to love you. Oh, give us a fresh sense of your holiness and a deeper gratitude that you should accept us. Help us to know you as you are. Help us to fear you, reverence you, worship you, stand in awe with you, of you. But also help us to take delight in your fatherly love and mercy. So send down your Holy Spirit. Send down the Lord Jesus Christ into our midst. May he dwell in our hearts by faith, and may we, dear Lord, know that we have met with you. Be with us now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As part of our reading, I want us to prepare for the sermon by reading Psalm 15. O Lord, who shall sojourn in your tent? Who shall dwell in your holy hill? He who walks blamelessly and does what is right and speaks truth in his heart, who does not slander with his tongue and does no evil to his neighbor, nor takes up a reproach against his friend, in whose eyes a vile person is despised, but who honors those who fear the Lord, who swears to his own hurt and does not change, who does not put out his money at interest, and who does not take a bribe against the innocent. He who does these things shall never be moved. I like to sing psalms, as you know, and I like to encourage you to sing them as well. This is maybe a new tune to you, and certainly new words if you're not used to that tradition. But these words are so powerful. And even if you're not singing along, I want us to worshipfully and humbly read these words, because they're profoundly challenging to us. So will you either sing or listen to, Lord, in your tent, who with you abide? A great question for us to ask: who can abide in the dwelling place of our glorious God? Will you sing this with me to his glory?
Lord, in your tent we will with you abide, and on your holy hill by your side. Who works of righteousness, who speaks the truth in all.
Can we pray? Heavenly Father, we bow our heads again and we ask for your mercy and grace. Lord, we need your grace, your mercy and your forgiveness because, Lord, these words that we've just sung remind us that we are not holy. We are unable to do the good things you call us to do. We hear the challenge, Lord. We long to fulfill them, but we need your forgiveness. So may the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ blot out all of our transgressions. May we, dear Lord, be blessed and equipped by you to live out this new life. And so, Lord, we pray for spiritual renewal. We pray that you would give us a deeper love of Christ and that love of Christ would drive out our love of sin. Oh, Heavenly Father, reassure us of your love. Prepare us this side of heaven for the glories of eternity. Bless us, enable us to do your holy will. Oh, Heavenly Father, we call on you in your grace and mercy. Please have mercy on us. Father, we have physical needs and financial needs, mental health needs, spiritual needs. Lord, we are broken and we live in this broken world in broken bodies. And Lord, we long for our day of redemption. But Lord, until then, we will need your grace, your healing, your mercy, your forgiveness. Please supply our needs. We lift up to you our loved ones as well. We know, dear Lord, that in the church there are many people that have lost loved ones. We pray for your grace and mercy on them. Pray especially for those that have lost loved ones recently, those that are unable to travel abroad to go to funerals. Oh, Heavenly Father, please pour out your grace, your mercy, and your love on them. Reassure them of your love. Please give them your blessing and healing. Lord, we lift up to you those that have financial needs. Please meet those needs. We pray for our friends and neighbors. We pray that they would know that they're being prayed for our families that don't yet know you. We pray, dear Lord, that they would know you as a prayer answering God and that would be the first step towards salvation in their lives. As they see that you make the difference, draw them into the life of faith, draw them into Christ, draw them to our glorious Savior. We pray for this broken world of ours. And Lord, we have been distressed to hear about the floods in Germany. We pray, dear Lord, that you would bless and help the Germans to be able to rebuild, that you would be a consolation to those that have lost loved ones. Have mercy on them and bless them. And we also pray for South Africa. Lord, it's been horrifying to hear about the rioting and the bloodshed, the mayhem that's been over there. Have mercy on that nation. Please keep your people safe there. Lord, we lift up these things to you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Going to continue to challenge ourselves as we sing this, our next song, Take Time to Be Holy.
Take time to be holy, let
going to come to the Word of God now, and as always, we come to God reverently and worshipfully, asking that the Holy Spirit would speak to us, challenge us, comfort us, and convict us so that we can live a new life to our glorious God. So let's do that. Heavenly Father, please send down your Holy Spirit. May he fulfill all of these things in our hearts as we hear from your word, and help us, dear Lord, to live out these things in our life. In Jesus' name, amen. Continuing our series as we go through the book of Hebrews, we're slowing right down. There's lots of wonderful applications that we can live out in our lives in chapter 12. And we're looking at six different things over the coming weeks, six different applications. Everything that we've learned has to now be lived out in our lives. So let me give you the context again, starting at verse 1, chapter 12. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin that clings so closely. And let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Therefore, lift up your drooping hands and strengthen your weak knees and make straight paths for your feet so that what is lame may not be put out of joint, but rather healed. Last week, we looked at verse 12, the first half of verse 12, strive for peace with everyone. And this week we're looking at, and for the holiness without which no one will see the Lord. Think of that. Strive for the holiness without which no one will see the Lord. Those are strong words. Can we take them as strongly as that? After all, at the beginning of this service, I asked you a question. Is holiness, a life of ethical purity that we seek to live in the face of a holy God, and a life of righteousness, a life of consecration and devotion to the worship of God and to the fellowship with his people, is that an optional extra just for some super Christians? Is it like having leather seats in an otherwise an upgrade in an ordinary car? It's just an optional extra, a luxury. Or is it absolutely integral? Well, I gave the analogy of being born and how breath must accompany birth, otherwise that you're faced with the tragedy of a stillbirth. And if you believe that you can be, you can make holiness an optional extra, then really, if you think that you're born again, have you been born again into a stillbirth? Have you taken that breath? Ideally, God is always pointing us and striving us towards a life of holiness. And so holiness is something that must be pursued. We must be constantly be pursuing holiness. So I want to convince you of the necessity of holiness. We're to strive for holiness without which no one will see the Lord. In other words, it is not an optional extra. It's something, if we've truly understand who Jesus is, if we love him for who he is, in that he loved his Father, he loved his Father's law, he sought to be obedient to him, he lived a perfect life. And if we find that desirable and admirable, then our deepest longing should be to be like him. Our deepest longing should be to see the Lord as well. And so Jesus tells us pretty much the same thing. He says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, the day of judgment, on that day many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do mighty works in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye workers of lawlessness. He's talking about people there that thought that living a holy life of loving obedience to Christ was an optional extra. It's just enough to believe the right things. And if you believe the right things and you feel happy about that and you're excited and sometimes you sing God's praise, that's enough. But Jesus wants us to be transformed by the power of the gospel. He wants to show that the true work of God has begun in this life. And yes, we may struggle to live that out. And yes, we may stumble, but the challenge is still there. We read earlier Psalm 15. It's there in the Old Testament, it's there in the New Testament. The same challenge. Who can dwell? Who can sojourn in the dwelling place of God, in the tent of God? Who can dwell on God's holy hill? Who does God delight to count among his people? We have a description of people that are seeking to live out a moral life. It's not that that moral life saves us, it's that moral life is a reflection of our desire to become more and more like Jesus. Let me read this. Jesus, who walked blamelessly and did what was right, Jesus spoke with truth in his heart, Jesus did not slander with his tongue, Jesus did no evil to his neighbor, nor take up a reproach against his friend. Jesus, in whose eyes a vile person, such as the Pharisees and the hypocrites, were despised. Jesus, who honored the fear of the Lord. Jesus, who swore to his own hurt and did not change. Jesus, who did not put out his money at interest. Jesus, who did not take a bribe against the innocent. Jesus did all of these things and he was not moved. This is a perfect description of who Jesus is, and this is who we should be longing to be. Having been saved, we fall in love with him and we say, Lord, help me to become more like that. And so we're told to pursue holiness, strive for the holiness without which no one will see God. It's something that we have to keep chasing after. Maybe if we speak to Anne in our congregation, she's got a greyhound. I don't know about the ethics and morality and the safety of the dogs when they're doing greyhound racing, but I do know that they run an awful lot faster when they have something to chase. And so, I've put a little red circle around this. You can see up in the picture there, that little red circle is surrounding a stuffed animal. It looks kind of cute, a little bit dumb actually, that this little rabbit, stuffed animal stuck on the end of a pole, is attached to a rail. And that rail is like a railway line, and the greyhounds chase after that stuffed rabbit. And they try and get, and their biggest desire as they're running is to try and bite and grab hold of that rabbit. Now, the operators of this stuffed rabbit, they have to be quite skilled, because always they know that if the rabbit gets too far ahead, the dogs will give up and the race will end. But if it's too slow, then the dogs will catch it. But if they get it just right, they can help the greyhounds fulfill their potential and run faster and faster. And in the same way, we should be seeking to see Jesus. He should be our greatest motive. He is always going to be 10 steps ahead of us. He is always going to have that distance of holiness against us, ahead of us. But if we love him, we will pursue him. We will continue after him. We will go on and on seeking to be more and more like him. And so we never, ever give up, because we desire him as our ultimate prize. We long for that great day when we are with him forever, when we are transformed into his image. But until then, we continue to pursue him. I don't know if you've ever been to Holland. I visited there once or twice. Beautiful country, very flat, of course, very, very flat, because it's built on marshes. It's built on the delta of the River Rhine. It's much of it has been reclaimed from the sea. Here's a map. You've got in the 1300s, huge, huge areas of the land was underneath the North Sea. And over the last 700 years, the Dutch have been reclaiming more and more of that land. What they do today is they go out into the North Sea, they dredge up stones and sand, and they squirt them onto land. And they start to build up the depth of the land till eventually they can reclaim it. And then they, on that new reclaimed land, They defend it by putting down big rocks and stones so that the sea doesn't come in and wash away the sand and drag it all out to sea again. And to be able to keep it drained, they have to use windmills. Today, they don't just use windmills. Those were used for hundreds of years, and those windmills didn't grind flour. They pumped water. Every time the wind blew, more water was pumped out of the polders. It was an ongoing exercise. It's something for 700 years they have never, ever been able to stop doing. Today, obviously, they use diesel pumps and things like that, but the principle is exactly the same. They can have this land if they keep draining it. They can have this land to grow their crops on and expand their cities on if they keep draining it. It's a work of constant progress. And in exactly the same way, you and I can never, ever afford to give up seeking to be holy. It's a pursuit that we carry on doing through the whole of our lives, because the moment we stop is the moment when we start to sink. It's the moment when sin and the love of this world and the devil starts to flood in again and ruin all the work of Christ. In 1957, that's pretty much what happened to many parts of Holland. In 1953, there was a terrible flood, and many of the polders and towns and cities were flooded in this tremendous breach of the walls. There was a terrible storm, and the North Sea came flooding through, and vast, vast areas of the country were reclaimed by the North Sea. But within days, as soon as the storms had stopped, people were out there. Even without machinery, they were taking their sandbags and they were trying to hold back the North Sea. They hadn't given up. And in exactly the same way, you and I must never give up. Yes, there will be times when you and I fall into sin. No, we'll never be sinless and perfect in this life. But just like the Dutch trying to rebuild their lives in the Dutch polders after the storms of 1953, in exactly the same way, you and I must never give up of seeking to be holy. Yes, we may fail. Yes, we may fall down. But the moment the storm's over, we get up. We ask for God's strength and his grace. And we say, Lord, please forgive me. Now help me to rebuild the sea defenses. Now help me to rebuild and reclaim what you have declared for your own. Help me, dear Lord, to live that out in my life. And so it's a pursuit that we must continue to go on and on, chasing after, building towards, never giving up, never being complacent. And when we go through a time of declension, when we go through a time of backsliding, when we go through a time of feeling that we've let God down, or we've become apathetic, or we've allowed other things to crowd into our lives, then we repent. And then we seek God's strength. And then we start to drain the swamps of sin again. And then we start to reclaim those areas of our hearts and our lives for the glory of Christ. It's an unending process until it is ended in heaven. So if we're going to pursue holiness, what means does God make available to us to be able to live a holy life? We can try to be holy through two things. We can try to be holy through guilt or through love. Guilt is a very, very powerful motive. Guilt is largely how politics works. Much of political and many charities and many lobbying groups, they use guilt. You are supposed to feel really, really bad about these things. And the way that you stop feeling really bad about yourself and who you are is to take on these new attitudes, these new values. And if you support these causes, then your guilt will be taken away. That's used very powerfully by the world, because the world knows how to manipulate people. And I can freely confess, wrongly, but truthfully, many churches and many individual Christians have tried to motivate themselves and others through guilt. You wicked sinner, God won't love you if you carry on doing that. If you want to please God, you must do this, 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 and this. And the same thing is very powerful. It works, and that's one of the reasons why churches and individuals have tried to use and motivate people through guilt. Because it works. But I don't believe that that is the way that God wants us to pursue holiness. Rather, I believe that we must pursue holiness out of love. We need to be returning to the cross to get rid of our guilt and then pursuing Christ out of a pure love and devotion to him. Look at Psalm 73. It says, the attitude of our hearts. Whom have I in heaven but you? There is nothing on earth I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. Do you hear the psalmist's love for God there? Do you see how that becomes the motive, the fuel, the energy that helps him to keep going on and on in his love and devotion to God and his desire to live a faithful light to him, to overcome all of the doubts and all of the lies of the world, to say, no, God and God alone is my pursuit. That is what frees us. That enables our service to God and his church, to one another in his church, to one another in our friends and our neighbors. It's love. Love of God, love of Christ, love of neighbor, love of our fellow brothers and sisters in Christ enables us to get involved in the community of God in his church. It's a love of Jesus. But it's also God makes available to us what I call the means of grace. It's not a phrase that we find in the Bible, but it's the shortest, most succinct way I can give you of trying to sum up a really wonderful idea, which is that God makes available to us means so that we can grow in grace. In other words, if we neglect these things that God gives us, we won't grow. We'll struggle in holiness, we'll struggle to grow in Christlikeness, we'll struggle to overcome our sins if we neglect these things. But if we use them, our lives can be changed. And so, the means of grace sometimes are summed up simply to the word and sacraments. We read the word and hear it preached. We then go to the baptism and the Lord's Supper, and those are true. But the means of grace go beyond that. The church itself is a means of grace. And for those of you that are watching this at home and through health reasons and through old age, you're unable to come to church. I'm sure that if you know and love the Lord Jesus, it's a heartbreaking thing for you. I'm sure that if you've been following Christ all of your life, you would love to be here in the church, worshiping and meeting with your brothers and sisters in Christ. It's a blessed thing to be involved in a good church. Because week by week, you see like-minded people who share your struggles, your aspirations, your desires. They're different from you. Some of them are older, some of them are younger, some of them come from different countries. But together, you have a common purpose, which is to know and love and follow Jesus. And so if we neglect the church, the very thing that God has given to us, if we neglect that, we neglect our own holiness, our own standing with God. And so we grab hold of that. And yes, if we go to a good church, I hope and pray that if you're not attending this church, you're trying to find a church that preaches the word of God faithfully and uncompromisingly. I hope and pray that you're seeking to be challenged by what the word of God says, not by the opinions of the preacher, but by a preacher who explains to you what God has said in his word. There's another means of grace. Another means is personal Bible reading. If we neglect reading our Bibles, we will miss out so much. Let me give you an example. This is from Galatians chapter 5. We need to hear these things because we tend to get fixated on just one sin. But as we read through our Bibles, we're challenged by many, many different things. Now, the works of the flesh, Paul says in Galatians 5, the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalry, dissensions, division, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and like things. Now, that's a pretty radical list there. And there's other lists like it that we'll find scattered throughout Paul's letters. He's a great list maker because there's many different areas that we fall down in. Now, I suspect that for probably most of my viewers that are watching this, you haven't been to many orgies too recently. But on the other hand, the challenges are still there. Do you ever struggle with jealousy? Do you ever struggle with fits of anger? Do you ever struggle with rivalries? These are many, many different areas where we have to work on in our holiness. But he goes on to say, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. And these are positive areas that we are striving towards, Christ-like features. We turn our backs on one, we hear the challenge of the Holy Spirit, and then we look forward and we say, oh, I want to be more like Jesus. I showed you this slide earlier of the way that Holland has changed over the last 700 years. But imagine that they didn't bother trying to reclaim all of that land. Imagine that they took all of that stuff that they dredged up from the seabed in the North Sea, all of that, and they'd just decided to concentrate on one mountain. That way, if they could make this mountain strong enough, it would never be at risk of flood again, and they could all go to there. And yet, if they concentrated all of their time and all of the 700 years of resources on just that one mountain, it would be trivial in comparison. Just a tiny, tiny fraction of the land surface of Holland. If you took everything that was dredged up, rather than do that, what they did is they just concentrated on many, many different areas. And they built up all of those areas over those 700 years. And it's so important for us not to fixate on just one sin and think, oh, if I could only overcome this one sin, and ignore all of the others. And so we need the Word of God to constantly remind us. Either we look at the Ten Commandments and it reminds us that we fail God in 10 different ways. That helps us to stop obsessing about one particular sin. And then we read more and more applications of the Ten Commandments as we read through what Jesus taught us and what Paul and what Peter teaches us in their letters. We seek to become more and more like Christ. So he becomes our main pursuit. That unending desire to become like him, to reclaim the lost land that the world, the flesh, and the devil has let sink beneath the sins of ourselves. We reclaim that for Jesus. We declare, no, this is for Jesus. We don't obsess over any single one sin, but rather we work on all of them. And the irony is that if we work on all of them, often that one besetting sin that we struggle with most, as we deal with all of the other faults that we have in our lives, that one sin starts to become less and less important, and we gain more and more strength from God to be able to overcome that one sin. So we become well-balanced, well-rounded. We don't obsess over any single one thing, but rather we seek to live the whole of our lives in all of our thinking, all of our behavior, all to the glory of Christ. We use the means of grace. We use Christian fellowship. We use the advice of one another. We use the singing of God's praises. We use all of these different things that God makes available to us to motivate our holiness and to push us on to know and to love Jesus. And so we never give up on seeking to be holy, because that is part of our life, part of our breath, part of our deepest desires, to know and love Jesus. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we fail you in so many different ways, but we thank you that you never let us give up. We thank you and praise you, dear Lord, that you constantly pursue us. And you give us Jesus to strive after. And Lord, may we be like greyhounds chasing the stuffed rabbit. May we have that dedication and single-minded focus to keep striving to become more like Jesus. Oh, dear Lord, continue that work in this life, a work that will never be completed until the next, but give us the desire to do it for your great glory. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to conclude our worship now with this final hymn, Take My Life and Let It Be Consecrated, Lord, to Thee. I know this to the tune, Take My Life and Let It Be. And I searched everywhere online and I just couldn't find a nice version of that hymn tune. So we're going to be using, I think it's what I call the American version of it. Certainly very, very popular. I could find dozens and dozens of this tune. So will you sing with me, Take My Life and Let It Be? Wonderful, challenging, powerful words that we sing to the glory of our God.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of Thy love, at the impulse of Thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for Thee. Take my voice and let me sing always only for my King, always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages for Thee. Take my silver and my gold, not a mite would I withhold, not a mite would I withhold. Take my love, Thy God, I pour, at Thy feet its treasure store. Take myself and I will be ever only all for Thee, ever only all for Thee.
I hope and pray that this video has been a challenge to you, even as it was a challenge to me personally as I prepared for it. We want to live our lives to please our God, but we also delight that we come to a loving and forgiving God. And so may you know God's equipping strength to live out the Christian life throughout the whole of this week, but also the wonderful consolation that even when we trip and fall, God loves us and forgives us. May you go in that strength all of this week. And now, will you say the grace with me? The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.